Good morning, family. I would like to wish every mother watching a happy Mother's Day. I pray you are well and you feel the love from those around you. We thank God for the mothers, and we thank God for the women that have taken on the responsibility of mothering us throughout our lives. I want to take this time to wish a happy Mother's Day to my mother and the spiritual mother of Fivefold Ministries, Prophetess Sharita LeBrain. We thank God for placing her in our lives. She is indeed the truest definition of a godly mother. I know many of us are celebrating from home. Some of us are with our mothers and our mother figures, and some of us are away from them. So I encourage you to take time today and give them a call or send them a text and just tell them how much you appreciate them. The Bible says for us to give honor where honor is due, and our mothers deserve to be honored on this day. Glory to God. I want to bring to your attention on this Mother's Day a word entitled job description. Many of us have endured broken relationships, broken friendships, broken marriages, broken parenthoods, because we didn't realize that God gave us a job description that was meant to secure and sustain those relationships. Whether it be a friendship, a marriage, the relationship from a mother to a child, or the relationship from a child to a mother, and even your relationship with God, they all have a biblical job description. Once you understand and operate in your job description, you'll find the peace and contentment you've been searching for. What is a job description? It is what is expected of you. It is what is required of you. In other words, it is the responsibility associated with your position, the responsibility associated with your position as a friend, the responsibility associated with your position as a daughter, the responsibility associated with your position as a son, and in conjunction with the celebration of Mother's Day, it is the responsibility associated with your position as a mother. You have responsibilities, things that people expect of you. People are depending on you and looking to you. People are calling on you and in need of what you have. And you might make the mistake of saying to yourself, you have nothing to offer and you have nothing to give. But I've come to tell you that you are a well of substance. For Luke 8:3 says, and Joanna, the wife of Chuza, Herod's steward, and Susanna and many others, which ministered unto him of their substance. What you need to understand is that your substance ministers. Your substance heals. What is your substance, mother? What is your substance, woman? It is, number one, your gift. Number two, your compassion. And number three, your testimony. Number one, your substance is your gifts. It may be money or wealth. It can also be your talents or your skills. Your gift is your possession. It is what you are able to bring to the table. Number two, your substance is your compassion. It is the nature of love. It is your forgiving and long-suffering nature. Sometimes you ask yourself, why do I keep forgiving people? Why do I keep giving them second, third, and fourth chances? It is your nature of compassion, and it is precious to you. And since it is precious, you need to guard it and never let anyone take advantage of it. Number three, your substance is your testimony. It is your story. It is your history, the fabric of who you are and where God brought you from. Woman, I urge you to never be ashamed of your past. Mother, never be ashamed of where you came from, because that story made you who you are and is the key of ministry. It is the key to minister to your children. It is the key to minister to your grandchildren, the key to minister to the people God placed in your life. Mother, you ought to speak it on yourself and say, I am a woman of substance. Mother, you have a substance and it is not just for you. That knowledge isn't just for you. That compassion isn't just for you. That gift isn't just for you. That testimony isn't just for you. It is for you to reach those around you. Woman, you have a substance to minister. And make no mistake about it, your substance has the ability to reach. But right now there are women listening that are struggling to find peace. There are a lot of mothers struggling to find peace. The reason why we aren't able to find peace in our various relationships with people is because many of us have turned the season of our lives into a lifestyle. You see, life comes with seasons. Seasons that are meant to begin, progress, and come to an end. I'll say that again. Seasons are meant to begin, progress, and come to an end. But the enemy wants to trap us in one cycle and stop the progression of our future. So we end up wandering in one place and stuck in a dry season. You see, the children of Israel in Numbers 14, 1 through 4, wanted to turn the season of their lives in slavery into a lifestyle. They wanted to go back to Egypt, back to slavery, back to the past, and that stifled their progression and caused them to wander in the wilderness for 40 years. It did not matter that they were on their way to the promised land when their minds were imprisoned to a season that had already come to an end. It doesn't matter that you received a prophetic word if you are holding on to dead relationships. It doesn't matter how much potential you have if you are holding on to toxic friendships. Woman, it is time for you to troubleshoot your life. I said, shoot the trouble out of your life. You know they aren't good for you. You know they don't want to see you succeed. You know they are wishing for your downfall. It's time to let go of the past so you can start on the journey towards your future. Oh, mother, if you only knew, there's so much greater for you. In the midst of all this trouble, there is something greater on the inside of you. In the midst of all this confusion, God wants to use you to reach your children and to reach your grandchildren. But you need to move past all of the distractions being thrown your way. I know for some of you it's hard for you to trust. I know you're hurting and you've been hurt in the past, and that is because you've misplaced your vows. There are specific biblical vows associated with relationships, and I want you to know that God respects and honors vows. Once you make a promise, once you make a vow, God expects it to be kept. But Numbers 30 and 2 says, if a man vow a vow unto the Lord, I swear on earth to bound his soul with a bond, he shall not break his word. He shall do according to all that proceedeth out of his mouth. For a married couple, a vow from a husband to a wife is found in 1 Corinthians 7, 3 and 4. And says, let the husband render unto the wife due benevolence, and the husband have not power of his own body, but the wife. Likewise, in the same chapter, a vow from a wife to a husband states, also the wife unto the husband, the wife have not power of her own body, but the husband. Vows from a parent to a child are found in Proverbs 22 and 6. And says, train up a child in the way that he should go, and when he is old, he shall not depart. Vows from a child to a parent is found in Colossians 3 and 20. Children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing unto the Lord. And Proverbs 1, 8 through 9 says, my son, hear the instruction of thy father, and forsake not the law of thy mother, for they shall be an ornament of grace unto thy head and chains about thy neck. Hallelujah. Those are just a few biblical vows we find in scripture geared towards various relationships. The problem is when you take a vow that was meant for someone else in your life and impose it on another individual. When you do that, you are misplacing the job description of that relationship. Everyone has a job description and a responsibility to occupy in your life, and you have a responsibility to occupy in their lives. But we often place bigger burdens on people than what they are able to bear. We fall out with family because we place demands on them that they were never able to fulfill. Till death do us part was a vow between a husband and a wife made at the altar before God. That wasn't the vow between you and your kids. The vow from your children was that they should obey their mother and father so that they may have long life. Did you see the different job descriptions at play there? Hallelujah. Your vow coincides with your job description. You may ask, what is a vow? A vow is a promise of servitude. When you vow something, you are making a declaration of service. And what you must understand is that your servitude requires sacrifice. And someone watching right now has given and given and served, and you've gotten dismayed with the concept of servitude because it seems like all you do is give and all everyone else does is take. You've been tipping to others, but I prophesy God's going to send somebody to tend to you. You've been sowing into others, but I prophesy God is going to send somebody to sow it to you. You've been praying for others, but I prophesy that God is going to send somebody to intercede for you. I'm talking about the mothers that have sacrificed, the women that have given their last, shed so many tears there weren't any left to cry. God is sending help. God sent Naomi a daughter. It wasn't her blood daughter. It wasn't the daughter she gave birth to. This daughter was married into the family, and God sent her help in the person of Ruth. He sent her somebody that was willing to love her, take care of her, and learn from her. Mother, you won't be forgotten. All you've given wasn't in vain. God will take care of you, for you are his daughter. You may be a mother, and you may have people you are responsible for, but God is your father, and he is responsible for you. If he has to send ravens, he's going to feed you. If he has to rain manna, he will sustain you. If he has to part the Red Sea, he's going to keep you. For what you have sown, you will reap. And what you have planted will spring up. I know those kids been acting up. I know they're not acting in the way you've raised them. But God is going to turn it around. I know it seems like everything is falling apart. I know you're stressed out and it seems like everybody is leaning on you. You feel tired and burdened. But mother, help is on the way. I said I decree and declare that help is on the way to your address. Help is on the way to help you get through this. If you receive it, you ought to give him praise right where you are. Proverbs 14:1 says, every wise woman buildeth her house, but the foolish plucketh it down with her hands. Woman of God, you need to build your own house. Build up the people in your house. You may say, how do I build my house? You build your house with your faith and your words. But the Bible says, thou shalt decree a thing and it shall be established. Mother, your husband is a blessing to you, even when it doesn't seem like he is. I dare you to call him a blessing every day. Don't call him lazy. Don't call him useless. Call him a blessing. Mother, your children are a blessing to you. Each and every one of them. They might be running wild. They might be stressing you out. Lay down the stress and pick up your faith. And call your children a blessing. Don't call them crazy. Don't call them selfish. Call them a blessing. And speak it into existence. And watch what was once a burden become a blessing. Watch what was once a curse become a miracle. Watch what was once stressful become easier. When you see a weak area, build it up with your word. When you see an issue, build it up with your faith. For you are a woman of faith. You are a woman of substance. And you are a virtuous woman. Proverbs 31:25 says, strength and honor is your clothing, and you will rejoice in times to come. Your time of rejoicing is on the way. Gone are the days of crying. Gone are the days of suffering. Gone are the days of hurting. Gone are the days of sleepless nights. Gone are the days of frustration. Your time of rejoicing is on the way. You won't be able to stop smiling because your time of rejoicing is on the way. You won't be able to stop dancing because your time of rejoicing is on the way. You won't be able to stop testifying because your time of rejoicing is on, is on, is on the way. You want to declare it? My time is on the way. My time is on the way. You may have been last, but you're about to come first. You may have felt like the tail, but you're about to be the head. You may have thought it was over, but a woman, you're just getting started. Because your time is on the way. Your time is on the way. Your time is on the way. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And if you have prophetic faith, you'll build your own future with the power of your tongue and speak it into existence and say, my time is now. I need you to look at your phone screen, look at your computer screen, look at your television and speak it with me and say, my time is now. For the Bible says that two or three are gathered in his name, there will I be the God in the midst. I'm in agreement with you. And if you're in agreement with this word, I need you to type, my time is now. My time is now. I'm walking into my future because my time is now. I'm walking into my destiny because my time is now. I'm walking in confidence because my time is now. I'm walking in faith because my time is now. I'm walking in virtue because my time is now. I'm walking in substance because my time is now. I'm walking.
you would like to give an offering, sow a seed, or make a donation, text the word GIVE to 833-519-0293. We thank you for your interest in supporting Fivefold Ministries. Your contribution furthers the vision of this church and the mission of spreading the gospel abroad. God bless you.